IA-AMTAS stands for Interacoustics Automated Method for Testing Auditory Sensitivity, and it is a method of performing automated audiometry. Automated audiometry has been in the literature for many years, first described by Hewson Westlake in 1944 and subsequently by Beckersey in 1947. These two methodologies provide an automated audiogram and are well established and still in use today. We find today that these techniques are mainly used across the following areas. Firstly, occupational health screening, such as screening for hearing loss in factories or those occupations where workers are exposed to high levels of background noise. Secondly, the Beckersey test is still used for cochlear and retrocochlear testing to identify the location of pathology. We also see automated testing frequently used in the military. Here, military personnel are exposed to significant noise and therefore hearing needs to be tested regularly, and automated hearing tests provide an effective method of doing so. Lastly, we see this technology being used in school screening settings. As we know, as children get older, the prevalence of hearing loss increases, and therefore school screening is still a common method for identifying those who have acquired hearing loss between birth and school age. However, to date, there does not exist a robust and validated method for providing an automated diagnostic audiogram or speech test. IA-AMTAS has been designed to do exactly that. It allows for automated air conduction and bone conduction audiograms to be acquired. This is done with masking using a novel masking procedure. In addition to air and bone conduction, the clinician can also perform speech audiometry. Here we can record word recognition scores as well as the speech recognition threshold. Therefore, IA-AMTAS takes automated audiometry to the next level. Before we look at how it works, let's have a look at the research foundations behind the test. I want to make reference to a study which was published back in 2007. Margolis and colleagues looked for a method for determining the accuracy of an automated test. In this paper, they produced the QALIND methodology. QALIND is a quality indicator for automated tests. It can be applied to any behavioural or physiological test which requires a response from the patient, and therefore is not just exclusive to hearing testing. In addition to the first criteria, each test which it can be applied to must also have factors associated with its accuracy. And lastly, there must be an independent measure which the automated test can be compared against. In the case of automated audiometry, we know that audiometry is a behavioral response. The patient pushes a button, and this is the feedback which we require in order to determine if the patient has heard the sound or not. Secondly, automated audiometry is also associated with many factors which can affect its accuracy. For instance, the test-retest reliability, the false alarm rate, as well as the test time. Lastly, automated audiometry can be compared to manual audiometry, therefore satisfying the third requirement for QALIND. So let's now focus on automated audiometry. IA-AMTAS is a method for diagnostically assessing air conduction, bone conduction, and speech audiometry, all with masking. The subject undergoes a series of psychophysical procedures where they are presented with either a tone or a word, and they are required to determine if they can hear that tone or word. Catch trials are included throughout to ensure reliability after each trial. The data then undergoes a quality check process to assess the overall quality of the data. This provides the basis for the automated hearing test. So let's have a look at the quality indicators behind IA-AMTAS in a little bit more detail. IA-AMTAS has 8 quality indicators which can be used to assess the accuracy of the overall result. The first quality indicator refers to accuracy. This looks at the predicted average absolute difference between automated and manually tested thresholds. It is derived from an equation taken from a study which I'll present to you a little later in this presentation. The second quality indicator relates to the masker alert rate. The masker alert rate is the proportion of thresholds for which masking noise was presented to the non-test ear at a level which may have been too low or too high. This is then divided by the number of measured thresholds. This tells us if there were any cases of undermasking or overmasking. The third quality indicator is time per trial. Time per trial informs us of the elapsed time from the onset of the stimulus to the subject's response, averaged across all responses. If we have very long delays from the subject in responding to the stimulus, then this could tell us that the quality might not be as accurate as we would expect. The fourth quality indicator is false alarm rate. The false alarm rate is the number of trials in which the subject reported the presence of a stimulus when no stimulus was presented. This is then divided by the total number of catch trials, and by catch trials I mean trials in which there was no stimulus presented. This gives us information on whether the patient was guessing or not. The fifth quality indicator is the average test-retest difference. In IA-AMTAS, the average test-retest difference is the difference between the 1000 Hz test and the retest thresholds measured. The sixth quality indicator is the quality check fail rate. The quality check fail rate is the number of occurrences of quality check fails. Here I mean a failure to respond to stimuli presented at supra-threshold levels. The last two quality indicators relate to airbone gaps. The seventh quality indicator looks at airbone gaps which are greater than 35 dB, and the eighth quality indicator looks at the number of airbone gaps below 10 dB. Together, these eight quality indicators will then provide us with an overall value of the quality of the automated audiometry. This is then presented in the software through a traffic light system. If the quality is indicated as red, then this tells us that the quality of the results is poor. Amber tells us the quality of the results is fair, and green tells us the quality of the results is good. So in addition to obtaining an automated audiogram, the clinician can then identify the overall quality of the audiogram, the overall quality of the results, and then make further investigations or changes depending on that quality. So let's now look at the studies which were used to validate IA-AMTAS as a reliable clinical test. I want to firstly refer you to the paper shown at the bottom of the screen. In this paper, Margolis and colleagues performed three studies. The first study looked at what is the intertester difference for manual audiometry. Once this was obtained, the second study looked at how IA-AMTAS compared to manual audiometry. The third study then looked at the intersubject variability for forehead versus mastoid bone conduction thresholds. The reason why this study was performed was because the bone conductor location in IA-AMTAS is different from traditional pure tone audiometry. Because masking is presented throughout the test, it is recommended in IA-AMTAS to place the bone conductor on the forehead of the patient. Let's firstly look at the first study. As we would expect, the intertester difference, i.e. the results from one patient tested by two audiologists at different times, was low. The mean difference was 4.1 dB for air conduction and 5.4 dB for bone conduction, therefore confirming the accuracy of performing manual audiometry. The second study then looked at how AMTAS compared to manual audiometry. In this study, patients underwent manual audiometry and subsequently underwent audiometry using IA-AMTAS. What the results showed was that the air conduction thresholds obtained by both IA-AMTAS and manual air conduction audiometry compared favorably. BC thresholds were slightly elevated with IA-AMTAS in comparison to manual audiometry, but these were within the 95% confidence intervals established in the study previously. This showed that IA-AMTAS provides comparable threshold information to manual audiometry. The final study, which looked at bone vibrator location, showed that the difference between forehead and mastoid bone conduction thresholds, which can be seen on the graph on screen, showed that the results are very similar for the two placement sites. Therefore, this supports the forehead location for performing IA-AMTAS. These three studies sit alongside a wider body of evidence looking at the development of automated audiometry. and the development of IA-AMTAS. If you're interested in learning more, I direct you to these studies. But for now, this concludes the first video on IA-AMTAS.